there's one thing they do right in Cuba, it's healthcare.
And it may be surprising to see just how much the Cuban healthcare system is thriving.
Cuba has the best healthcare system in the entire area.
One thing that is well established in the global health community is the strength of the Cuban national health system.
Despite being a poor country, Cuba has one of the strongest healthcare systems in the world.
And in many respects, much better than the U.S.
And so now, after all these years, one thing is clear. The Cuban people have free, universal health care.
El sistema nacional de salud cubano está destruido. Los consultorios están en muy malas condiciones.
Los hospitales abarrotados. La gente muriéndose en los pasillos. Los pacientes sin oxígeno. Hospitales sin corriente eléctrica.
No sé si se ha visto en lo que suben las personas a redes sociales. Eso es pura realidad.
Since the 1959 Communist Revolution in Cuba, there have been hundreds of newspaper articles, magazine features, news segments, and documentaries celebrating the marvel of its healthcare system.
Even President Castro talks openly about Cuba's long list of economic mistakes, but everyone approves of at least one investment the government has made in free universal healthcare.
All the independent health organizations in the world, and even our own CIA, believes that the Cubans have a pretty good health system.
It's all part of an elaborate propaganda campaign that disguises the reality of Cuban healthcare. Its clinics lack most routine supplies like antibiotics, bandages, syringes, and oxygen, and in some cases, running water. Their hallways are often occupied by ailing patients because there aren't enough doctors to treat their most basic needs. And its hospitals are unsanitary and decrepit. Cuban healthcare is exactly what you'd expect in a country impoverished by communism. The only thing that's changed is because of social media and the COVID-19 pandemic, the government's propaganda facade has finally started to shatter. And yet, in 2021, some journalists were falling for the claim that the Cuban government had set the model for its response to COVID.
We begin today's show looking at how Cuba has successfully fought the pandemic. Since last year, only about 440 Cubans have died from COVID-19, giving the island one of the lowest death rates per capita in the world.
3 months after that broadcast, Cubans took to the streets and to Twitter and Facebook, in part to call attention to what the pandemic had actually meant for the island nation's healthcare system.
In the past few weeks, Cuba has experienced its biggest spike in coronavirus cases yet. At the same time, it is getting harder to find food on the island.
The protests that swept across Cuba, the largest in decades, stunned the communist-run government.
In the 15 years since the release of Michael Moore's documentary Sicko, which celebrated Cuban healthcare,
their only sin when it comes to healthcare seems to be that they don't do it for a profit.
Everyday citizens have been armed with smartphones, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, empowering them to tell the truth about what it's really like to walk into a Cuban hospital. So when you say that all you have to do to realize the truth about the Cuban healthcare system is actually go to Cuba, well, you have the example of someone who did go, who was Michael Moore, and he came up with Sicko, which obviously presents the Cuban healthcare system as a great triumph.
I meant do not go on one of those stage Potemkin tours.
Maria Werlau is an author, analyst, and the founder of the Cuba Archive, which promotes human rights through research.
He went to a facility that was prepared to receive him, that was part of this montage. You know, clearly, that wouldn't stand today because you have so many videos coming out, I think, from facilities in Cuba.
Is that due to social media?
It's due to social media and to telephones. People are, you know, it's almost daily. Thing is, it's mostly in Spanish and mostly you have to look for them. But if you go on YouTube and, I mean, on Facebook, it's daily. Daily, people are posting this.
So how did the Castro regime's propaganda machine manage to fool so many for so long? The answer lies with Cuba's foreign medical missions, which are teams of healthcare professionals dispatched to provide emergency and routine care to foreign countries. The first medical mission was sent to Algeria in 1963. After the fall of the Soviet Union, when the government lost its major source of aid, the program was ramped up significantly as a source of revenue for the impoverished nation. The Cuban government has promoted the missions as a humanitarian endeavor and a demonstration of the community spirit and selflessness that's central to the communist project. In his 1960 speech on revolutionary medicine, the Marxist revolutionary Che Guevara said that individualism must disappear in Cuba.
He recounted the story of a group of physicians in Havana who demanded remuneration before going into the country's rural areas to treat the sick. He dreamed of replacing them with a new class of doctors drawn from the peasantry who would run immediately and with unreserved enthusiasm to help their brothers.
Nuestro país era capaz de enviar los médicos que se necesiten a los más oscuros rincones del mundo.
This will be a battle of solidarity against selfishness, is a Fidel Castro quote inscribed on the wall at the medical school in Havana, alongside a map showing all of the places in the world that the medical missions have served.
Cuba produces a lot of physicians in this country, and you know where they go? They go to poor countries around the world doing a lot of good.
They become known around the world as being one of the most generous countries in providing doctors and medical equipment to third world countries.
It's a big show. The Cubans get off the airplane wearing their white jackets, you know, after a long cross-Atlantic flight with their flags. You know, not even Doctors Without Borders, that has an amazing program, has that kind of propaganda behind them.
What fantastic work the Cuban doctors have done.
That they should be nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize in 2021.
For the Nobel Peace Prize for 2021.
And I'm very happy to nominate them.
Porque cuando tú le das un premio a una brigada, ninguna de las personas que participó en diferentes cosas va a recibir ese premio. Ahí le van a dar un diploma, aplauso, van a seguir trabajando, no le van a seguir pagando. Y el mundo va a seguir pensando que lo que están haciendo está bien hecho. No está bien que utilicen a las personas para el beneficio de un gobierno.
Dr. Roce Rios Molina participated in the medical mission in Sierra Leone in 2013, where healthcare specialists from around the world came to help contain the Ebola epidemic. The members of the mission were told that when they returned to Cuba, they would be received as heroes and that the government would give them each a new car.
¿Cuánto recibían ustedes en Sierra Leone?
Bueno, en Sierra Leone no recibimos salario.
Nada.
El problema fue que Cuba dijo, nos dijo a nosotros, que nosotros íbamos voluntarios. Voluntario, porque como era una epidemia tan letal, tan fatal, incluso que se pensaba que se podía morir gran parte del personal sanitario que asistiera a esa misión, nos dijeron que nosotros íbamos voluntarios, que eso era solidaridad.
Dr. Rio says he did receive a stipend that went to cover his living expenses. Medical personnel from other countries, on the other hand, were generously compensated.
Y resulta ser que todas las personas que estaban ahí de otras entidades, por ejemplo, Organización Mundial de Salud, médicos de España, de Canadá, médicos de incluso de aquí de Estados Unidos, de Médicos Sin Fronteras que estaban ahí trabajando, fueron voluntarios también, pero le pagaban, que era la diferencia. Sin embargo, los médicos de otros países que trabajaron conmigo ahí, que tuvimos la oportunidad de conversar, ganaban $7,000 mensualmente. Quiere decir que se estaban jugando la vida, pero estaban recibiendo una compensación monetaria por lo que estaban haciendo.
Dr. José Ángel Sánchez, who was part of a medical mission in Venezuela and fled in 2015, points out that host countries are paying for these services and that the money is going to the Cuban government instead of the doctors who are doing the work.
Y un pago de alrededor de, en aquel tiempo, de $7,000 por médico al gobierno cubano. Y el gobierno cubano, a su vez, le pagaba a cada médico el 0,03%, que vendrían siendo $5 o $6 al mes. No más de eso.
The myth of Cuban physicians as selfless healers started to fracture in 2000, when two doctors from the mission in Zimbabwe slipped a note to an airline official with the handwritten word kidnapped. They had denounced the Castro regime and were being brought back to Cuba against their will, possibly to face jail time. Instead, they wound up in the US and were granted political asylum. In a 2020 report, Human Rights Watch said the Cuban medical missions violate doctors' fundamental rights, including the right to privacy, freedom of expression and association, liberty and movement, among others. They noted that many doctors feel pressured to participate in the missions and fear retaliation if they do not, and that governments that accept Cuban assistance, that includes the abusive conditions imposed by Cuba, risk becoming complicit in human rights violations.
It starts from the recruitment and how it's done. That is not fair, that is not transparent, that does not tell the doctors what conditions they're going to face when they go, does not give them an option to say, I want this or not, or I agree to it or not. To begin with, the employment is a problem, but then they're forced to leave their families in Cuba. They cannot bring them with them. And if they abandon the mission, or they, let's say they don't want to continue anymore to be in the mission, and they want to stay in Brazil or Venezuela or South Africa or whatever, they are prevented from going back to Cuba for at least 8 years. There's specific laws that they could be put in prison for years, because they're considered traitors.
For the past decade, the United States has encouraged Cuban doctors and nurses working outside Cuba to defect to the United States.
In 2006, the George W. Bush administration created the Cuban Medical Professional Parole Program, granting healthcare workers stationed abroad permanent resident status. All they had to do was make it to a U.S. embassy. Over 7,000 medical workers took advantage of the program.
President Barack Obama canceló este proyecto por petición del gobierno cubano. Porque obviamente es un proyecto que quitaba o ponía en peligro toda esta trata, todo este negocio ilícito que hace el régimen de La Habana.
Dr. Julio César Alfonso is the president of the Miami-based Solidarity Without Borders, which helps Cuban doctors who have escaped.
Este programa funcionó perfectamente. Tuvo algunas irregularidades durante los años que funcionó, pero todo fluyó bastante bien.
In 2014, the New York Times op-ed page published an editorial calling for an end to the program. American immigration policy should not be used to exacerbate the brain drain of an adversarial nation, it noted. In other words, the rights of doctors to decide where and how to live should be subordinate to what was best for the Cuban government.
¿Hay alguna posibilidad, alguna manera de que se vuelva a instaurar?
Y aún actualmente no ha habido mucho progreso al respecto, pero seguimos impulsando a través de diferentes contactos en todas partes para tratar de restablecer algún tipo de programa que beneficie a estos profesionales que escapan de esta esclavitud. Pero hasta ahora, es decir, no ha habido mucho éxito. Pero lo más positivo es tratar de eliminar que esto siga sucediendo. Y eso es lo que debe trabajar la comunidad internacional.
After the mission in Sierra Leone, Dr. Rios was redeployed to a military base in Mexico. One day, he was sent with a group of doctors to buy some phone cards so they could connect with their relatives back home. He decided to make his escape.
Me fui quedando rezagado en el grupo cuando ya estábamos en la calle y había una estación del metro. Me agaché como si fuera a cortarme los zapatos, salí corriendo. Le supliqué al oficial que estaba y el hombre, gracias a Dios, puso la tarjeta y me dejó entrar al metro. Avancé dos paradas del metro, salí a la superficie otra vez, llamé a unos pacientes míos que estaban en México que me estaban esperando. Y ellos me fueron, yo les dije, mira, estoy en tal dirección, y me fueron a buscar.
Dr. Rios found a job at a Mexican pharmacy to start saving money to pay a coyote to bring him into the U.S. He was picked up by the Border Patrol and taken to an immigrant detention center for 42 days.
Es bastante malo estar detenido en un lugar como ese. Más para mí, no sé, que nunca había tenido la oportunidad de ir a una cárcel ni nada de eso. Eso es muy desagradable.
In 2018, a group of Cuban doctors who defected from the medical mission sued the Pan American Health Organization, which is part of the World Health Organization, for aiding in human trafficking and for earning $75 million in fees for acting as a middleman.
La Organización Mundial de la Salud y la Organización Panamericana de la Salud son protagonistas directos en este programa ilícito de trata de personas. Ellos tienen un papel protagónico en esta situación porque son quienes manejan directamente los contratos con el gobierno de Cuba, de casi todos los países donde se realiza este tipo de actividades. Son fondos de las Naciones Unidas, son fondos que la mayoría de ellos provienen de los Estados Unidos y van a parar a las arcas de un régimen totalmente totalitario. Claro. Es algo realmente increíble.
The medical missions are primarily a way of selling Cuban healthcare services abroad. But what's healthcare like for those living on the island?
Cuba, quite surprisingly, has a very advanced biopharma industry.
Unlike the rest of the developing world, there's no doctor shortage in Cuba.
We've seen wide improvements of Cuban health across the population.
Providing a kind of care that's both personal and persistent.
Trabajé en hospitales muy del pueblo, de la gente de a pie, con condiciones pésimas de trabajo, donde son contadas las jeringuillas que hay en el día esterilizadas para poder inyectar a un paciente. Los espéculos, que es el instrumento con que se hacen los exámenes vaginales a las mujeres embarazadas o a cualquier mujer.
Cuando ponen un documental, ponen el mejor policlínico, ponen el mejor hospital. Por ejemplo, yo antes de venir para acá, trabajé en una clínica internacional, los dos años antes de venir.
Una clínica internacional es donde van los turistas.
Donde van los turistas. Sí. Yo trabajé en la clínica internacional Sierra García, que está en Playa. Uh-huh. Allí, por supuesto, que la atención es mejor. Ahí hay todos los medicamentos, ahí hay todos los medios diagnósticos para hacer los pacientes, las camas son diferentes. Por supuesto, eso es turismo. Ve a un turista y lo primero que está pensando es que te va a dejar $20. Porque te va a resolver. Con $20 vas a tener más que el salario que tú tienes el mes entero. Entonces, ese paciente tú lo priorizas, le das la mejor atención porque es la forma que tienes de salir adelante.
Hay dos sistemas de salud en Cuba. Uno destinado a la población común y otro destinado al turismo y al personal de élite.
When defenders of Cuban healthcare acknowledge its deficiencies at all, they usually point the finger at the U.S. trade embargo, which has been in place since 1962.
For decades, Cuba has heavily invested in its medical and pharmaceutical system, in part because of the six-decade-old U.S. embargo.
Cubans tend to blame their hardships on the U.S. trade embargo.
One of the biggest problems remains the embargo of medicine from U.S. pharmaceutical companies.
But the deplorable conditions in Cuban hospitals have more to do with a lack of basic healthcare supplies, which are readily available from other countries, such as antibiotics and steroids.
Cuban hospitals also have a shortage of beds and stretchers, and some are without water for 6 to 12 hours a day at the height of the pandemic. So what impact does the embargo really have on Cuban healthcare? Medical products have been technically exempt from the embargo since the passage of the 1992 Cuba Democracy Act, but the law does stipulate that U.S. companies need a license in order to sell to Cuba, and critics are correct to point out that this requirement adds red tape to the process.
Total U.S. healthcare products purchased by Cuba from 2003 to 2021 averaged a mere $1.4 million annually in what should be a $50 to $100 million market. But it's not the licensing process that accounts for such paltry sales. Companies would gladly obtain permission to sell their products to Cuba if they could earn enough money to make it worth the effort. Cuba has a severe foreign currency shortage because it produces little in the way of goods and services that the rest of the world wants to buy.
¿Y de quién es culpa eso? ¿Del gobierno de Estados Unidos? No. Señor mío, eso es culpa del gobierno de Cuba. Porque ron, la bebida alcohólica, no falta. Sí, el cigarro tampoco falta.
Promoters of Cuban healthcare often cite the country's infant mortality rate as evidence of its success.
And yet, the Cubans are able to have a lower infant mortality rate than the United States.
Cuba has similar life expectancy and lower infant mortality than the United States.
How is this possible that an American infant is, by official statistics, almost 50% more likely to die than a Cuban infant, wrote Nicholas Kristof in a 2019 New York Times column that looked at one of the most often repeated figures in support of the claim that there's something exceptional about Cuba's healthcare system. While conceding that the figure should be taken with a dose of skepticism, Kristof chose to interpret them regardless in support of his priors. Cuba has a Medicare for all that many Americans dream about.
Por ejemplo, las cifras que publica el régimen cubano acerca de una tasa de mortalidad infantil muy baja.
En Cuba todo se manipula.
Cuba has a variety of strategies for manipulating its infant mortality rate, such as seeing to it that fetuses less likely to survive outside the womb never get the chance. There's significant evidence that Cuban doctors coerce women into aborting fetuses shown to have abnormalities after routine ultrasounds.
We have to understand that the physicians in Cuba are a member of the army, and they have to meet certain targets in terms of infant mortality, and if they don't meet those targets, they face penalties.
Vincent Galoso, who's an assistant professor of economics at George Mason University, co-authored a 2018 paper arguing that Cuba's low infant mortality rate in part is a result of misclassification using a different indicator known as late fetal deaths.
Late fetal deaths are things that happen before birth and early neonatal deaths, so in the first 7 days. That means you reclassify the early 7 day deaths as late fetal deaths. That way they don't pop into the official statistics. And we can actually look at statistics of how their ratio of late fetal death to early neonatal death are for most Western countries. The ratio is generally 4-1, 6-1, whereas Cuba is like an outlier where it's 14 or 15-1, which is a clear sign of this distorted set of incentives. So there is, once you adjust for that, you find that Cuba's infant mortality rate goes as high as doubles, sometimes increases by half of what it is, sometimes twice what it is.
Despite reports early in the pandemic that Cuba was an outlier in its success in combating COVID,
Cuba has far surpassed the United States when it comes to COVID-19 and people surviving.
Y de repente hubo un rebrote que colapsó todos los servicios.
By August of 2021, the New York Times was reporting that Cuba's healthcare system was reeling, with oxygen supplies running low, a shortage of syringes, and mortuaries and crematories overwhelmed. President Miguel Díaz-Canel blamed the U.S. trade embargo.
Los médicos subiendo videos para las redes sociales del caos que había, las personas diciendo que no hay medicamento, no hay médicos, quiere decir que es que no funciona.
En estos momentos, la isla colapsó. El sistema de salud colapsó. Los hospitales abarrotados, la gente muriéndose en los pasillos, los pacientes sin oxígeno, hospitales sin corriente eléctrica, no tienen la suficiente fuerza o energía para tratar casos de esta magnitud.
Dr. Rios has three kids, ages 7, 12, and 16, still living in Cuba, and he's hoping to bring them to the U.S.
Que en Cuba, siendo médico especialista con tantos años, no podía hacerlo. Aunque es, mira, ahora mismo estoy trabajando como ayudante de carpintería. Y soy especialista hace más de 8 años, pero no me importa. Porque como ayudante de carpintería puedo mantenerme yo y puedo ayudar a mantener a mi mamá, por ejemplo, a mantener a mis hijos en Cuba. Yo dije que quería ser médico a los 9 años, pero hasta que eso llegue tengo que hacer lo que tenga que hacer. ¿Y quieres que te sea sincero? No me importa. De verdad. Sinceramente te lo digo.
El pueblo cubano va a despertar. Y el pueblo cubano va a levantarse más fuerte que nunca. El pueblo cubano se dio cuenta que no existía ningún enemigo exterior, ni un enemigo anterior. El enemigo del pueblo cubano es el gobierno cubano.